Enough, yeah, we're good to go. So, guys, we're live here. Again, this is our youth development series, and it's an honor here to have Ollie Logan with us. So, Ollie is a works with British Swimming. So, yeah, so I'm going to let Ollie introduce because he'll be able to talk more about himself. So, Ollie, if you want to introduce yourself to the listeners.
Thanks, Gary. Yeah, absolute pleasure to be on this. So, thanks for having me. So Ollie Logan, I work as analysis lead for British Swimming. So what I'm in charge of is all the performance analysis, the biomechanical analysis, and then the skill acquisition work, which I'll expand on what that is at a later date. So I work full time for them. Slightly crazy in that I live in Northern Ireland, commute over and back every week, but you know, you've got to pay the bills somehow.
I may not be happy, but
well, yeah. I guess I'd say, or before I worked for British Swimming, so I was working there. I'm working there now for 18 months. I had worked for 10 years for a company called the English Institute of Sport. So they are essentially sports science and medicine providers to all of the Olympic athletes within GB. So, and that was predominantly in the area of biomechanics, working on quite technical sports such as archery, a little bit in gymnastics, athletics. Also did some stuff with wheelchair basketball, bob skeleton, squash, so quite a lot of sports during the time. So but after Rio, wanted a bit of a shift to British Swimming, so quite fortunate I've been to two Olympics, multiple world championships and stuff like that.
So that's nice. So we touch a wee bit just on that. I know it's kind of on the topic of youth development because people want to strive maybe towards that.
Yeah,
what was it like actually being at some of those Olympic games, you know, just actually physically being there? Because a lot of people won't experience it.
Absolutely, like incredible, like, yeah. Incredible. I think I went to London and Rio, and obviously London was a home games, and it was like you're a celebrity for 3 weeks. You know, if you had the tracksuit on and stuff like that, it didn't matter whether you were a coach or an athlete or a member support staff. Just people just wanted your time and wanted to be around you. So, and I think I'm quite fortunate that experienced that, because we never experienced that probably for another generation.
Yeah. True.
But yeah, just unbelievable, and in terms of like the feeling, even it's weird because you're in the bubble in the Olympic Village, but when you do get to venture out, it's just an unbelievable feeling and kind of mood, because the Olympics are on, it's home Olympics. Rio was slightly different in that, and obviously over in Brazil, so you're slightly kind of more removed, but that was kind of, in terms of the location and kind of geography of where you were in Rio, it was like amazing place to be. Like the village and all the venues are good, but you did see like a lot of the bad parts of Rio as well,
yeah.
Like when you're driving through and stuff like that, but both were amazing to be part of. And like, you kind of still don't realise the scale of it. It's like 26, 27 world championships all happening at once.
Like
20,000 journalists, 10,000 athletes. It's unbelievable the amount of logistics and infrastructure that goes behind it.
That's
so
good. Well, hopefully we get a few more athletes from here can experience the next one.
Yeah, yeah.
At the minute, you're working and you're aiming for Tokyo 2020.
Yeah. So we work kind of every 4 year cycles. Our funding is basically based on Olympic success. So Tokyo will be the next one, yeah, in 2020.
And we were talking as well too, obviously you're working with swimming and you're doing obviously a lot, but one of the areas you've been talking about is, we came up with early specialization, is that obviously the sport like swimming, you do put in the hours.
Yeah.
You do, and it's straight turn,
swim.
But do you find that some of our athletes in Team GB, that they just have that early specialization, is actually restricting them doing better at swimming?
Yeah. So I guess from what I've seen for younger athletes coming through, and this is just not swimming, but and even when I was in the EIS, is certainly in the last 4 or 5 years we see younger athletes coming through specialized a lot earlier. So by early specialization we probably mean probably spending more hours than their age during the week, or doing that one sport. It doesn't mean that they're solely in one sport, but they're doing that. That would be kind of the definition we would use of it. But certainly a lot of them would have been kind of solely on that sport for a number of years prior to coming on to like a funded program, etc., etc. And what we find is that actually the we have to do a lot of work with them physically to develop them, so they're quite used to doing their movement patterns that are sport specific.
Yeah.
But outside of that, with any gym based specific stuff or any kind of physio pilates or physio kind of prehab work we have to do, they actually never really had much variability out of those specific movement patterns.
Yes.
And you know, there's quite a lot of research around this. You know, that it's a bit of an injury risk because they're continually moving and using those kind of structures of the joints and bones and muscles, without having that variability. And then when variability does happen within kind of the sport, is, you know, again, that's an injury risk as well, because they're not able to cope outside of that. So
can't do that. I like that term that you said about for the early specialization. That's a good one for parents and everybody out there is at that age. So whatever age you are, you know, be careful. I suppose more so it's not a given, you don't have to, but just be careful that if your child is 8 years old and they're just playing one sport for 8 hours that week, it's something maybe you have to consider and maybe drop that out and have to, again, get them into something else. So, on that as well too, is there anything that you find what would be kind of the best things for people to do at a younger age to help them rather than being caught in the early specialization trap, more or less?
Yeah, well, I think a big thing for me is like experience multiple kind of sports and activities, whatever that may be. Certainly from a physical perspective, things like gymnastics, judo, where they understand kind of their full body activities, they understand kind of proprioceptive awareness, so awareness of their body and joints and limbs and stuff like that. They're certainly really good. So probably combined with that, you might want to have like a team-based or tactical sport where you have to work in teams, kind of have a kind of social development as well. And then something like a swimming or a cycling or you know, from a kind of physiological development as well. But really, there's no hard and fast rules to it. The more they can experience different activities, they actually will complement each other. But it's not, for me, it's not just about the physical development of kids as well. It's about kind of their kind of cognitive, kind of social development as well.
Yeah.
Because a lot of youth development programs that I'm involved in or that I've seen, often their end focus or goal is performance of the child. Now, a lot of youth development programs aren't actually focused on what I would probably term more the development of the child from a physical, from a social aspect. So is your development based on performance? And when you get one through your development program, you say, hey, this is a success? Or do you look on the development of the child and say, well, actually, we might have 20 kids in our program, 3 or 4 of them go on to a senior team, but actually we're developing them as better individuals to enable them with skills to go out into the wider world. So I think there's a big onus to do that aspect as well, because, again, speaking to a lot of people, is youth development programs are claimed to success because 1 or 2 come through, but nobody ever talks about the ones that haven't come through or quit the sport or anything like that. So that's a big thing for me, because you're trying to equip the kids to be better people, children, you know, as well, because it has an impact on school, it has an impact on their confidence, etc. It's not just in the sport specific nature.
Yeah, I would always say that about build the person first, an athlete second.
Yeah.
You always put the child first, especially coaching children.
Yeah.
You know, child centered session.
Yeah.
That is about that and the performance and everything. And we talked a bit about this, about, you know, again, it's good to win.
Mm.
It's good to teach them habits of winning and habits of actually, probably even more important, teaching them how to feel.
Yeah.
Because kids don't learn how to feel.
Yeah.
And that whole emotional side of it and the social side of it and psychological of, well, how do I react to that?
Yeah.
And, you know, teaching those habits of getting up, trying again. And, you know, you don't have to have big fancy terms or do anything. It's keeping it stupid simple, as I say sometimes.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
what can you do to improve this child?
Yeah.
And then if you improve the child, the athlete comes along with it too.
Yeah.
It's a bonus.
Exactly.
It is.
Exactly. And that's why I think it's good for them to engage in different activities.
Yeah.
Be it team, be it individual. You know, just because they get those opportunities to either work with other kids or people or do something on their own, or, you know, I think it just gives the child a greater tool set, both physically and kind of socially as well.
Yeah.
To be able to deal with things in either school or within their sport.
I think we talked about it. I like the way you set that up, actually, because if you think about it from a physical point of view, that if they are playing an individual, like a grappling sport or gymnastics, where it's full body, it's maybe high enough impact, team sport too, multi-directional.
Yeah.
And then when they can do swimming or cycling, where it's low impact, but they're still getting that physical adaptation, you know, cardiovascular, whatever.
Yeah.
As well, too, we mentioned before, just off before, we're talking about it's a culture.
Mm.
you know, in our society, if, you know, depends even your religion and what school you go to.
Mm.
You play Gaelic.
What you get exposed to.
And then if you go to a rugby culture,
mm.
where, you know, we see it on TV and a lot of people say, even the likes of refereeing,
mm.
how you speak and approach a referee compared to rugby,
yeah,
to soccer,
yeah.
or football, and or even the Gaelic.
Mm.
You know, the kids are getting exposed to that.
Yeah, yeah.
I know myself. I actually never played rugby, but I went and played it in college,
yeah.
when I was actually working up there, and played it in Saturdays. I loved it.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
the first thing that got me was everybody was calling the ref sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Excuse
yeah.
me, sir.
It's
excuse me, sir. Yeah, and it's like, I was only the captain.
Yeah.
Was allowed to do it. Like, at that age, when I was 21, and I'm going, wow. Like, and that was only it took me to 21 years old to actually go, yeah, you see it on TV.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
to go in and physically experience it.
Yeah, yeah.
And for kids to do that, I think it's massive.
Mm.
And it's different cultures. It's even finding out, as you said, even about that, you know, maybe what are they doing at the weekends, different
yeah,
kids.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You
yeah.
know, because you're stuck in your own wee bubble,
yeah.
your own wee environment.
Yeah.
Not just the physical movements, but the whole child as well.
But I think as well, like, you know, like as we were talking about before we started here, is where is the role of unstructured play as well.
Yeah.
So we'll have, from what I can see, we're reducing hours within PE within schools. We have probably most of which is structured anyway. There's a PE coach and there's a set task for them to do. They'll have their activities or their sports during the week. Again, it'll probably be a mix of structured and unstructured. It's actually, when do the kids go and play?
Yeah.
When do they go and play with their mates down the playground, explore, you know, just do climbing, you know, just explore the environment, that kind of stuff, where again, they just trial and learn. Because I'll give you an example, whereas I saw something probably a month or two ago. So I do most of my coaching is in cycling now, so I work kind of for Omo Wheelers now.
Shout out to my wheelers,
little guys. And so I was doing a session a couple of months ago, and kind of in it was down at Esport and
yeah.
the track there. And then in the middle, like there was a soccer session happening. So I was down there kind of setting up, getting everything ready, and the kids would come down, they're probably like 8-10 years old. And they came down and you know, about 20 kids there, and they just had the balls and they're messing about and kicking about, and you hear loads of noise and the kids interacting and laughing and creating little games and stuff like that. And then coach comes on and there's immediately structure placed on them, and the kids suddenly become a little bit more quiet, and there's order and there's cones to go through and stuff like that. And most of the voice you hear is from the coaches who are there. And then the session finishes and the kids are waiting to be picked up by the parents, and suddenly they engage in unstructured play again.
Yeah.
And there's suddenly more noise and interaction and stuff like that. Now, in terms of what the kids enjoyed the most, which part of the session, like, I don't know, I wasn't able to speak to the kids.
Yes, yeah.
But I can get, you know, I can see from their body language and the noise and stuff like that, which part they enjoy the most. But also from what they learned as well is if you're, again, this is probably an area of skill acquisition, which I probably specialise in, is how you structure the practice can have an impact on how they learn. So often, again, the traditional view is that if you do loads and loads of repetitive practice, that's the fastest way to learning. So we would probably call that a linear type style. But actually, that's not how people learn skills. Is if you want to get something better at something quickly, you do lots of block practice over a short period of time, and your short-term memory will pick that up and you get good at it. But that does not aid long-term retention.
Yeah.
So actually what we should have is kind of a non-linear, kind of quite a variable practice where kids or anybody is in an environment where they're encouraged to make mistakes, where they're actually have engagement in the practice that they're doing, where they have a feel of autonomy as well, where they can actually go and say to the coach, hey, what about this, or can we change it to this, and the coach is kind of welcoming on that. And actually that'll aid longer term retention. So kind of get back to the point is where is that unstructured play where kids get to go out to the playground and, you know, backyard football and stuff like that, where they have these and they get to try things
yeah.
without a coach being there. And often that, from what I see, certainly within youth programs and youth development work, is the coach actually a benefit or a hindrance by putting structure within that?
Yeah.
And are the kids actually enjoying those sessions? Because the biggest marker of any youth coach is, do the kids want to come back?
Yeah.
The big thing, it's not that they come back, it's do they want to come
yeah.
back, and the retention of the kids coming and actually enjoy it. Because we have a lot of competing activities out there now, particularly with, you know, the phones and video games and stuff like that. So that's a big thing. Even when I do my coaching, the first thing I think of is, how can I make it fun and enjoyable? And if we do that and integrate some of the skills into like games-based learning, or the term we use, constraints-based learning, where actually we try and put a bit of a rule on them, but the outcome is to try and explore that skill, then actually if they have fun, then we get them coming back, you know? So.
No, that's good, because that I see.
There's quite a lot in there.
No, it is. It just sparks a lot, and it comes down to my two philosophies of coaching, and I would say this to any of the coaches, even my own, is the first one, it has to be fun.
Mm.
No matter what we are doing at our core kids program, it's fun.
Yeah.
The second thing is, my overall aim is, can I get that kid to come back next week? As you say, want to come back.
Parents.
Yeah.
There you go.
They have to be realistic at times.
Yeah, yeah.
It's brilliant for parents to come.
Yeah.
And I say that, you know, people say, oh, all you're doing is babysitting service. This is brilliant, because it's an opportunity for me to actually engage with the child, to get them to want to come.
Mm.
So rather than the parents having to force them, the kid's going, can we go?
Yeah,
which thankfully we are getting a bit of feedback from the parents going, like they wake up in the morning going, is it Tuesday? Is it kids on today?
Yeah.
Which is good.
Yeah, yeah.
The other thing, then, we actually brought into all our summer camps this thing, and if people are looking at it, it might have looked lazy, but it was actually controlled chaos.
Mm.
But we just did free play.
Mm.
For the first 15 minutes, by the time everybody comes in and registered, it's a perfect opportunity. Now, I've been in camps before where people have all the footballs or anything, and like, don't take them out.
Wait till everybody
comes in the circle, get them sitting quietly. Whereas we did the opposite.
Mm.
Anything I had in my van, I took it out and left it. Now all the balls now were a bit soft. It was a bit safe like that, that it wasn't anything heavy or hard. Things were going to be kicked around. But we had noodles, we had frisbees, we had skipping ropes, thing. And literally the rule was, come and take it from here.
Go explore.
And go and go and explore.
Yeah.
And literally whenever, it just I shouted, okay, everybody stuff back. It was like, boom, they went, left it back. And when we came in and we did our stuff, we'd always have a wee routine. We'd do like yoga first and teach them stretches and different things.
Yeah.
But even through that, it was still like, I would say anybody take a dog for a walk. Or And if I seen a movement of a kid doing something that was thing, I'd be like, everybody stop on it, show us that again.
Yeah.
So rather than, I always say to coaches, just because a child maybe isn't doing the same thing that you said them to do, never first of all say, no, this is what we're doing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because a few things can happen. That movement actually might be really good and they're exploring.
Well, one of those things might be that coach might see, they see their movement solution.
Yeah.
But there are multiple other movement solutions. So again, I see that in quite a lot of technical sports is coaches will go, I'm going to impose my movement solution to this problem on you, without them looking at it and going, well, actually, if they explore, they could find a better movement solution than what I have based on my physical abilities, based on my height, based on, you know, all the kind of what capabilities the individual has. So that's a big thing, is imposing of technical solutions, because particularly in technical sports, is something doesn't look right. See that a huge amount, and it's very hard for people to get away from that as well. Like, I even struggle in some of the technical work we do with swimming is when someone doesn't look like a gold standard model, people really struggle to be comfortable with that.
Yeah.
Because as humans, we're attuned to notice change and notice difference. Like, if you're sitting in an airport, you'll notice someone with a limp or someone in crutches or stuff like that. So we're really attuned to that. But actually, what we need to identify is what's the fundamental scaffolding of movement that this person needs to be able to achieve the outcome?
Yes.
And what is acceptable variability within that movement? So there's good variability and there's bad variability of movement. So I think in technical sports, we can get tied down in what something should look like, and we've got all these models of how things should be and stuff like that. Well, actually, if everybody looks the same, then where does deception come in? How do you deceive an opponent?
Yeah.
Kind of stuff? If everybody looks the same, then you've got an easy tail.
It always comes back to that too, and what I say is a perfect model, because you look at that Sri Lankan cricket player, Malinga, who tosses the ball across his body.
Yeah.
So people are saying, well, if somebody fixed him at the start, would he be able to do, you know, Paul Radcliffe's running style?
Yeah.
Paul Radcliffe ran in their head, looked like it was the Churchill dog.
Yeah.
And people are saying, if somebody fixed her, would gain that fixed her into that perfect linear model, as you say, would they be able to do it? And the answer could mean yes, it could have been quicker, but you know what I mean? These are word
you can never say that as well. Yeah. I spent a lot of time doing biomechanical analysis and interventions with athletes, and that's what I always have to be careful of, is if someone doesn't look right and the coach is driving a change, I can't guarantee you're going to be better in the end.
Yeah.
We can probably say, yeah, based on efficiency, there's an injury risk here or a better performance, but we can't actually say that. The one I always use, I think, is real good, is Jim Furyk. He had a bit of a loop on the top of his backswing.
Yeah.
It was something that he just, I think, either he or another a coach put in just to help him as a kind of a feel-based reference of where he was on the top of the backswing. And here's a multiple kind of, you know, major winner.
Yeah.
So very variation does exist, and, you know, I'd encourage coaches to explore what good variability is with their athletes and with their kids. And there's, you know, kids are still exploring anyway. They're going to find different ways to do things. They've got, as they're growing as well, you know, they can take spurts and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So variability is not going to happen. Everybody's not going to look the same. We don't want everybody to look the same.
No. And I think we brought that topic up before, even that a lot of parents have come to me and said, oh, my kid, he's taking this cool spurt, but now he's really all his coordination and everything. And it's like, well, that's adolescent awkwardness that's going to happen. And they're giving them time for their body to adjust to their physical, you know, have they actually taken a growth spurt? Are they actually physically got stronger? Have they been doing some sort of a gym program? Then it's up to the coach and to the parents even to turn around and go,
that's why it's really important if your kid's taking a growth spurt and they're only doing one sport, then they only really get one opportunity of fixed movement patterns to explore their kind of their new body formation.
Yeah.
Because if they're doing multiple things, they're then putting themselves in different positions, and actually they'll start to understand their body a bit better.
Yeah.
So that for me, yeah.
I think that's the big key with that is obviously multi-sport but the free play. I always said the analogy of, it's like everybody's crazy about FMS, so the fundamental movement skills.
Yeah.
So if you had a house and your main part of your house was your FMS and the roof was your sport specific skills, but underneath that is your foundation. Even I think that we have to go lower than FMS, and that's where unstructured and play comes in.
Yeah, yeah.
Because as I was taking a class one time, it was P4 class, and I asked them a simple question. Yeah, who here has climbed a tree? And not one person in a P4 class
mad,
put their hand up. Whereas, not to sound old, back in our day.
Yeah, yeah.
But we used to, you know, we used to go out and we used to do all that. That it was just unstructured. And it was funny, the article that you sent me then, if you want to elaborate on that, was with the wheels that they did over there.
Yeah, so something I saw. Most of the stuff I pick up now is on Twitter.
Yeah.
Someone had retweeted it. It was in The Guardian last week about how Wales have put in a rule. So this is based off, I think, the UN Convention for Children's Rights, where they say that children have the right to access kind of free play.
Yeah.
So Wales have kind of taken this up, and they've put in, this is kind of a rule within councils and within schools as well, is that I think kids are entitled to 1 or 2 hours free play during the week. And as a result of that, then they've had to design and put in kind of playgrounds to be able to facilitate this and put it into kind of schools and kind of PE lessons and stuff like that. Or not even PE lessons, but kind of some time within the school kind of timetable to allow kind of free play, you know, the kind of unstructured stuff. But even I think in that is again, previously kids would have had to go out and they would have gone into the woods and there wouldn't have been dedicated areas for them to go and play. Now, particularly with urbanisation of a lot of stuff, is there are dedicated playgrounds for kids to go and play. And even if you go in and look at the equipment that's on there, it's quite structured. It's quite a linear way of going and engaging with that. One of the ideas I quite like, it's based on athletics, is an idea called an exploratorium. So there's one in Denmark and I think there's one in Germany. So it's based on an athletics track, but within this athletics track they've put dips and mounds kind of parkour style stuff.
Yes.
So there's athletics in it, but you get to like try kind of different skills and kind of run around and explore and put monkey bars in it and stuff like that. So the big thing about it is that kids go in there and they go, wow, it's immediately engaging, they want to go explore it.
Yes.
Is when you've been in the playground for a little while, you might have little different games and stuff like that, but they want to go into the woods, they want to go explore something that's kind of really engaging for the kids as well, like so.
No, it's a big one, and actually just talking about that parkour, I was reading Nicky Butt, his head of academy now at Manchester United, brought gymnastics and parkour people in to to coach because they were having a lot of upper body injuries through falling, through things. So kids now, that's how I said, to go back to the tree climbing, kids actually don't know how to fall.
Mm.
Like, I remember I always say, if you climbed a tree, how did you get down?
Yeah.
You jumped.
Jumped.
And you knew that you had to land, roll. Now, if somebody looks at a parkour now, they're going, oh, look at these hippies running around doing whatever. Like, there's a guy actually who was helping us coaching this summer, Michael Clark, and some of the stuff he was doing was amazing.
Mm.
Like, we had him dressed up as Spider-Man for one of the events he did, and he was phenomenal. Like, so, and it was even for me, we were down in the leisure centre and we did a wee short video. But after a while, me and him were messing about on the bank, the grass, and I was trying to do, I remember back in the days, we had to do the backflip off the ground. And so, even exploring those movements, kids don't do that. And again, at that top level, playing for Manchester United, something simple as, yes, I'm brilliant with the ball at my feet, but when I lose my balance and maybe put my hand down, try and stab it, I'm seized up, I don't have the ability to know, well, I'm going to roll here, and I can actually get up quicker.
I think a part of that is probably how he moved around or over something, the solutions that he had available to him are far probably greater than what you had. Now, that's either through experience but also kind of physical ability as well. We're going to encourage our kids to engage with different environments and then create kind of different solutions to that, and not be put off by saying that's wrong or don't do it that way. Then actually you allow the kid to be creative, you allow the child to be creative in that space, and that's going to transfer to other spaces as well. And allow the child to fail and make mistakes in an environment where actually they can do that. They'll do that in unstructured play because it's just kids playing, and all they'll get maybe is a bit of banter off their peer group or stuff like that. But if that's in structured play and you have someone who's respected as a coach saying, don't do it that way or that's wrong or stuff like that, then you're going to shut down that opportunity to be creative. And you're going to go, I'm going to go safe.
You know? I think that a big thing that comes back to is the language of the coach. I would always find if I am trying something in the kids, you know, because eventually they'll want to show you everything. And it'll always be fantastic. But maybe could we try it this way now? Or could you show me something else? You know, and again, it's that language where a lot of coaches will go no, and you said that, as you say, what they'll do then is they'll revert back to fight or flight, and they'll go back and they'll go, well, next time, play it safe, do what the coach has told me to do. Where in actual fact, rather than you think that you're helping them perform the skill, you're actually hindering their own ability to explore, their own ability to use.
And I appreciate it's challenging because actually, you know, we all want to perform, we all want to subconsciously want to win. So, but it's how much is driven by performance versus development. And that's the big thing for me is actually, as and in any youth development, we need these kids to be under 14 champion or under 14, you know, winner? Not really, if actually the long-term aim is to develop them socially, physically, and then if they do get good at the sport, then we want them to be, in the area that I work, we want them to be good winner at the senior level. You know, it's got that kind of longer term view. That whole thing around early specialisation, like, you know, there's loads of research out there that kids are under 12, under 14 champions nationally. Very, very few of them actually then progress onto the senior level. There's been quite a lot of research done on athletics recently where we've seen that. So I think it was one done on Irish athletics. And I think it was the under 12s. Only 10% of those Irish champions made it to a senior level. So, you know, the numbers still suggest that, like, early specialisation is not the model. There are maybe some sports such as gymnastics, maybe diving, where actually that natural maturation happens, or that early specialisation is a necessity for the sport. But
you also look then at the age of the cutoff of that sport. For most of those, especially gymnastics. You know, 14 and you're a veteran. you know what I mean? Especially with that. And so again, it obviously, whatever you say, there's different approaches, so many variables. You'd mentioned a lot of work with Adam as well too, in the swimming. You changed some of his, for how you adapted his kind of way. Did anything he do? Was he specialising? Like, obviously he's
going into stage because he probably didn't take swimming seriously until he's 15 or 16 years old.
Right.
And swimming, again, culturally, it is an early specialisation sport. I would question actually whether that's actually good or not, but you'll see a lot of kids going 11, 12 years old, getting up at 5 a.m, doing the mirrors, then going to school and stuff like that. So I think I still haven't rationalised in my head as to where the benefit is, because A, they're not getting enough sleep, which is massive for their development as well. But it's just, there's a cultural thing in the sport about putting the mirrors in, and you have to do it from a certain age and stuff like that. So But he never really took the sport seriously, as I understand it, until like 15, 16. And then started to kind of really push on. And fortunately, he met up with a coach, Mel Marshall, who saw his potential and was able to kind of track him in the right way. So, you know, that's certainly a key marker in his development. But he's really only been doing the sport, I'd say, probably specialising in the sport for about 7 years now. But obviously unbelievable kind of physical talent,
yeah,
as well.
He's a big guy.
Yeah, big guy, can just swim breaststroke, very, very different to the rest of the world. But some of the stuff we've been doing with him over the last couple of months, was working on a start. Now it's always been identified as an area of weakness for him. So he's able to, in terms of free swim, when he's on top of the water. So I mean, free swim is on top of the water and under the water. He's very, very good. His stroke rate is really, really high,
yeah.
And he's quite powerful to be able to do that. But under the water, it's always been his limiting factor, mainly because of his size. He's a lot of water to push out. So what we've been working on his underwater section, particularly his underwater fly kick. So in breaststroke, you're only allowed on one underwater fly kick.
Yes.
That's kind of the rules of the sport. So his ability to do that was pretty poor. He wasn't limited physically in terms of his range and mobility. So we actually worked quite a lot of that and introduced some variability of practice and what he was doing. So rather than the block repetition practice of fly kicking that he was doing, we actually did some stuff where he had to do stuff where he was restricted with his hands, where he had to do it up kind of the other way around, upside down. So basically getting to explore his kind of his motor, his kind of movement space, in order to find a more optimal solution for what he was trying to do.
That's even at that elite level, you're still looking for him to explore.
Yeah.
As you said, it wasn't just repetition, let's get this right. And we're like,
yeah.
Well, what other ways can we approach this? What other things can we do? So you're talking these 1%, well, milliseconds for these guys, like a touch of a hand.
So often these guys are used to kind of that repetition, that kind of, I would call linear style of learning, of just rote repetition. Whereas what we want to do is to kind of explore his movement space and then try and find a bit more of an optimal solution. So we would either use kind of a differential learning or constraints-based learning approach. The reason that we do that is because if they explore and then find a more optimal solution, it's far more likely to be retained and to stick under competition pressure.
Yeah.
Whereas if you're doing a block style, kind of linear style of practice, you're much more likely to resort back to default in competition. So we wanted something to stick. So doing our before and after, there was an improvement. And, you know, fortunately, as a good case study, he set a world record at the European Championships. So we're able to identify, actually, that he was faster in those sections. So
it's interesting, did you say about back to that thing where you only started when he was 15? I'm sure...
Are you swimming before then, but proper seriously?
Yeah, but I'm sure that even before then, it just wasn't swimming.
Yeah,
maybe that, you know, if somebody his size, his thing as well, yes, he had genetics to come in it, but I don't know if you know, or it'd be interesting to actually find out what other sports maybe he did actually involve with. Cause
I think he was involved a little bit of rugby. He's from kind of Derby Toxter collection in England, so I think he had a bit of a multi-sports background, but then, you know, he's pretty small, I think, when he properly took up swimming at 15, 16, and then I think he had a big growth spurt about kind of 18, 19 years old, so.
And
boom. Coincided with, he kind of broke on the scene in the 2014 Commonwealth Games.
Yeah.
As I understand the story, and then, yeah.
Gosh, that's good. I think it's a good point, a good kind of case study for that, I think we were trying to reconnect there.
That's right.
We're back on there. But yeah, I think we've covered a good bit there, I think, in the short space of time. Just even to recap a wee bit about, so we talked about the early specialisation. Especially maybe if we look at our own country now, about it might be a cultural thing. It's really trying to get our kids to perform loads of different things.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest thing we come back to is that unstructured play.
Yeah.
I think going back to that article as well, too, another point I was going to say was, there was adults there.
Yeah.
But they just stood back.
Yeah,
you know, they're there, and even when we did our free play within our program, like, it wasn't a time for the coaches to just hang around sitting on their phones. Our coaches were actually engaging with the kids in different ways. Like, there was one stage I looked up, and one of the coaches, Robbie, was getting annihilated with noodles. Like, they would use noodles for beating away at him, but they were going high, low, everywhere, and they were laughing and they were having fun. And we find, yes, we would take them in into different rotations where we give them samples of different games and stuff and get them to explore their movements even in that. But a lot of the kids, yeah, as soon as a structured free play was over, they just didn't engage.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and that came up to us to try and get them to engage.
Yeah.
But what we would do then, we would have lunch
and
the speed is probably not good for their own digestive system and stuff, but they would eat because then we'd give them another bit of free play.
Yeah, yeah.
Before we'd start a game.
Yeah.
You know, and it was good. Like, and even as well too then, with the kids exploring stuff, we would always finish each one with meditation.
Mm.
So guided meditation. So it wasn't always this whole thing of it's always bang, 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 bang,
yeah,
bang.
Yeah, yeah.
It's, can you control? Can you be in the present sort of thing? Mm. Can you get all your emotions? Can you kind of find all this? And
yeah,
it goes back to coaching the whole child.
Yeah.
Exposing them to them, letting them explore all these different scenarios, different movement, different things.
I think even like coaches just watching the kids in the structured free play, you actually see how they move and their level of engagement and stuff like that. You can start to pick out when actually kids, when they have autonomy and when they have engagement, actually this is what they look like, versus if they're standing in a line waiting a couple of minutes to get you know, one pass or stuff like that. Like,
yeah.
You know, those kind of things. So, but you can have structured and you can have that engagement. It just has to be, you know, you've got to think of it from the child's point of view. It's got to be kind of short, engaging. It's got to be games-based. You know, there's got to be kind of a purpose to it as well. It's not, what I'm not suggesting is people go wildly and just send all their kids out of the woods. Like, you can't. It's a difficult balance to do, and that's kind of where some of the coaching intuition comes in.
Yeah, that is the big thing. And I know that's something that you try and do as well too, with different workshops and trying to get coaches more engaged. I think that's, it comes back to the thing, and the other one I've touched on before is the culture.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the culture within the club. It's the coach's philosophy too.
Yeah.
You know, we talked about it that I think the coaching chart should be flipped around, that our best coaches should be our youth coaches.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's an absolute skill.
Yeah.
Because you have to be, you still have to be involved with them at the top level, but emotionally, physically, technically, tactically, everything has to be covered.
Yeah.
And they're a lot more vulnerable at that age.
Yeah.
Whereas if you were to say something to an elite person who's, you know, knows that they want this, knows that they're aiming for, knows that they have to make a sacrifice, and you're telling them, look, babe, this is what you have to do, no matter what, then not but saying it's a lot easier for a different coach.
They're more able to receive that kind of critical feedback as well.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
So yeah, no, I think there's definite value in that. But we have a system where it's kind of like a pyramid, where the best go to the top, be it coaches or athletes. So, but I definitely think that applies within any kind of youth development setup. But for me, it still comes back to what is the purpose of whatever club or structures youth development kind of framework is. Is it for performance? Is it to get that one person out? Or is it for development of the child or the youth as, not just as performers, but as people and kind of kids and mini adults almost moving forward? I think that's really important, because there's not many youth development that are actually perform or that have a bonus for performance. Certainly from a club perspective. So actually, what's the purpose of youth development? Is it to get people through, you know? So
and I think
keep coming back to that.
Yeah, it goes around in circles here, but that's the big thing. And I think it's very, one thing that coaches now, especially at youth level, don't be afraid of two things. Question your own ways.
Yeah.
But engage with the kids a lot more in terms of questioning them, asking, you know, what did you like?
Yeah.
Why do you think we are doing this?
Yeah.
What's the benefit of this? And it's that, again, that catch 22. As long as the coach has the why behind it and the kids are exploring the movement, you don't need to go in and overcoach them.
Yeah.
You know, let them do it. If you can see them doing a perfect hinge, or if they're in a decent squat position and it comes naturally.
Yeah.
You know, as I always say, we're all born to squat.
Yeah.
You know,
looking at my 18-month-old, she's perfect squat position. So we all have it, which is it. So yeah.
And again, that was another one I was coaching in the schools, and I did squat patterns with them just one day, and it was from P1 right up to P4, and everyone else just repeated some of the movements, and P1's bang, P2's bang, kind of there, getting there, P3's were struggling with you, the P4, especially the boys, struggled to get into a squat position. So I mean, everybody at P1, no problem. And there was a guy in P3, it was Ennis Gilder, actually, his family, he's an Indian, Indian kid, his family come over, the two of them were doctors, his mom and dad. And again, it was just, he was down, perfect position, knees driven out. I just simply asked him, he's like, very good, you know, do you be in that position or not? And you find out, well, that's how we eat
home,
that's how we go to the toilet back home. And, you know, he had fantastic form.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't even actually as engaged in them when it came to team sports because he wasn't really exposed to that background back home.
Yeah.
Whereas traditionally, we would hear a lot of team sport orientated. But it just shows you that we're all born with it, and it's just getting our kids to move, and sometimes we take them away from it.
There's a resource I think is really good. It's called Boing for Kids.
Right.
I don't know if you've come across it.
No.
So it's been developed by kind of a friend of mine over in the UK, and basically it's kind of developed kind of movement skills through games. And it's free. The resources are free. So B-O-I-N-G, Boing for Kids. If you just Google that and you sign up, then you get access to like, probably like 100 different PDFs that you can integrate into kind of different warm ups or different kind of structures and stuff like that. Definitely recommend.
That's
that.
Good.
Yeah.
So we're happy to have a round up. Is there anything else you kind of want to say on that,
I mean, if people wanted to kind of read further and some of the stuff that I read and listen to, so some of the podcasts I kind of listen to. So Talent Equation by Stu Armstrong is a real good one, particularly for kind of coaches who are working in talent and development. In terms of some of the skill acquisition stuff, there's a podcast called the Perception Action Podcast.
Okay.
It's by Rob Gray. And then some of the stuff, there's another one called Finding Mastery called by Michael Gervais.
Yeah.
It's quite a good one. I think in terms of books, you've probably provided quite a lot of books anyway, but there's one, The Athletic Skills Model, I quite like by Rennie Wormhart. So he's a youth coach at Ajax.
Yes.
And certainly looks at the kind of the variable movement and the kind of non-linear practice for development movement skills. So
it's a great setup there. They have bargaining courts and everything, and they have the running tracks for different hills and things too.
So that's Athletic Skills Model. It's worth a read, and it's not too technical either. It's quite readable by a lot of people. So.
That's good. And then you mentioned a few of the other ones. Is there any apps or anything that you would recommend or do, or you would use even in your own coaching?
Not really. I'll probably listen to the podcast and kind of just see what people are doing. So Stuart Armstrong's really good to listen to, and just probably follow the world of Twitter. So there's a lot of bad stuff on there, but there's a lot of good stuff on Twitter as well. So
I know it's one area that I actually don't. I'm obviously big on Facebook and Instagram and stuff, but Twitter is something I need to get in for my own learning.
Yeah. But I think as well, there's a Facebook group called it's a Coaching Science as well. So there's probably 5,000 people on that. Some good stuff goes on there as well.
Yeah. So again, there's loads out there, and I think a good point you made there too is it's having all this knowledge but applying it.
You know,
knowledge applied is just knowledge wasted.
Yeah.
So get out, apply it, try it with your kids just to see it.
Yeah.
Keep asking questions.
Yeah.
The minute I'm reading another book, it's by Tommy John. It's quite good. His dad, that they were at Tommy John surgery, the elbow, is a baseball player.
Yeah.
But now the thing is that this injury should be obviously with an adult because it's repetitive.
Mm.
But now they're finding up to like eight-year-old kids are going for this now.
Mm.
So he's come up with this movement thing. But again, I was picking the other, what I'm trying to implement to with core kids is parts of what he's doing to come and actually say, well, here's where our kids are at.
Mm.
Not to set like a benchmark, but just to see, right, well, can we teach them these movements? And can we see, just give a framework of where we think we are.
Yeah.
And maybe to highlight, not to scare parents or to say anything, say, look, your kid lower body strength is fantastic because they do play a lot of team sports and everything, but their upper body is, you know, is nowhere
sort of
near advanced
literacy.
You know, because we can't go around and FMS or functional movements screen every kid because it's very hard even to do with one team. Whereas the easiest can, I'm trying to incorporate it into my program, even make it fun of saying to you guys, getting squat racks and getting kids to hang.
Yeah.
For them even to see a barbell.
Yeah.
And then know, now they're not gonna have to go in, they don't have to front squat or overhead squat.
Yeah.
Just hang off it.
Yeah.
At least they're exposed to that equipment.
Yeah.
You know, and then whenever they come to the gym environment, they're like, oh, I don't know what that was, and that's a barbell.
Yeah, they're used to it.
The physical literacy, the whole thing of it, then they're able to move around it.
Yeah. But just have those basic movement patterns of run, jump, hop, push, pull, you know, all those kind of things, which if they get exposed to it through unstructured play, or even through the structured stuff, then, you know, it's just going to develop them physically.
Yeah. So well, that's good. Well, that was brilliant.
Cheers, Gary.
Really good. Thank you very much. It was perfect. And good luck with the Olympics too.
Yeah.
Bring home some gold.
Trust.
Bring home some gold. Yeah. So, guys, thank you very much again. If anybody is watching this, please, if you have any questions, just comment below. Ollie's tagged in this link as well too. And I'm sure if you want to get in contact with Ollie about anything.
Yeah, Facebook or on Twitter as well, at Ollie Logo, OllyLogo. Yeah, more than happy to speak to anyone.
Yeah. So kind enough to give us time here, so I'm sure I'll do the same with you guys. So thanks very much, and thanks for watching.